taking time out today. Let's start with just getting some of your information. Would you tell me your name, if you don't mind sharing your birthday? Tell me a little bit about your family.
My mother was named Mattie Murray Bailey. When she married a Bailey. My daddy was named Ernest Bailey, B-A-I-L-E-Y.
Tell me your name.
My name is Annie K. Bailey Ray, W-R-A-Y.
And Miss Ray, would you mind telling me your birthday?
March the 29th, 1912.
So that makes you how old?
101.
101 years old. Tell me about growing up. Where were you born? First of all, you mentioned your parents. Where are your people from? Where's your mother and father from? Do you know?
My daddy came from Milledgeville, Georgia. Now that's all I know. I never did know his mother or any of his family.
Do you know any of their names?
Mm-mm.
What about your mother's people? Where was she from?
My mother was born in Macon County, that's what you call Dooley, I think that was, no, Vianna was Dooley County. That's where I was born, in Dooley County, Vianna, Georgia.
And did you have siblings, brothers, sisters?
All gone home to be with the Lord.
Tell me who they were by name.
My oldest brother was named Willie Clarence Bailey, and they called him Black Beauty, because he was a good-looking, tall, black boy. My next brother was named Andrew Lee Bailey, and then I came the third child.
And you were the youngest, or were they anywhere after?
No, my sister was born after. She was named Ruby Claude Bailey. Faison. F-A-S-O-N. After she married, she was a Faison.
So there were four of you?
Five of us. Ernest Bailey, I told you, that was the baby.
The baby, okay.
That was five of us. Okay. I had three brothers and one sister, two girls.
And at what point did you come to Macon?
Now, in 1920.
Now, what made you come to Macon?
I had to come. I was old enough to go to school. My daddy was a railroad man. First he worked at the MDNS Railroad in Vianna. That railroad went out of business, and they shipped him from Vianna, Georgia to Macon. And my daddy moved up here, and he stayed, and he come home on a Saturday morning, stayed till Sunday evening, and he came back to be at work at, 8 o'clock. Mm-hmm. And he worked for the Central Railroad until he was on his way to work one Monday morning and had a stroke, fell with a stroke, and Daddy died. He was a member of Hoses Temple on Washington Avenue in Macon.
Is that an AME church or a CME church?
AME.
And do you remember what year that would have been?
No.
Okay. And then at that point, you had not moved here yet?
Yeah, we moved here in 1920, I told you that.
Okay. And do you remember where you lived when you moved here?
On Woodley Street in Pleasant Hill.
And
I wasn't old enough to go to school.
Okay, so you were a small child then.
Yeah, I was small.
And what do you remember about that early childhood and moving here to Pleasant Hill?
We lived, when Daddy moved us from Vienna to Macon in 1920, I wasn't old enough to go to Green Street School. We had some good neighbors on Woodley Street, lived in, Mama had five children and Daddy, and we lived in a house with two rooms and a kitchen on Woodley Street.
Do you remember who your neighbors were that lived around you? Any of the names stand out in your mind?
One of them was named Miss Drury Clark, Miss Susie White, Miss Mary Pinchston, had a daughter named Constance Pinchston. That's who my oldest brother went with. That was his girlfriend, Constance. And she got a daughter. I talked to her the other day. All of them gone. My oldest brother was named Willie Clarence Bailey. He worked at Hubbard Smart's on Cherry Street, and they called him Black Beauty.
Now, what's Hubbard Smart? Is that a store?
Was a men's clothing store on Cherry Street, downtown.
Now, your early childhood, you were a youngster. You weren't in school yet. Tell me about family life. Did your mother work? Did she stay at home? Tell me about what home life was like.
The house was on Woodley Street, two rooms and a kitchen. Mama washed and I. For white people, we had to tote, carry, I would say carry, not tote, but carry wood from the branches and from places to put around this big white, big black a pot where Mama boiled clothes at. We had to tote water from the spring.
Up. Where was this spring at?
Under the hill on Wood, right up under the where the cemetery is. Linwood Cemetery.
Okay, and so that's what your mother did. That was her...
That was her income from washing and ironing for white people. We had to go get the clothes on the Monday morning, and when she got through with them, we had to carry them back to various places. And I never will forget the first white lady was named Miss Davis. Lived on Pierce Avenue over there where the offering home was for white children on Pierce Avenue. I never will forget her.
What made her so memorable?
She called my mother and asked her, could I come and help her after I got out of Sunday school from Hostess Temple? And Mama told her, yes. Yeah. So I went out there, come home from Sunday school, changed my clothes, went to Miss Davis' house on Pierce Avenue. I washed the dishes, swept the front porch, the sidewalk, and, you know, just did around in the kitchen and cleaned up. I never will forget the first dollar and a half I made, and that was my first dollar and a half on Pierce Avenue. If I had a car, I could tell you and show you the how.
About how old were you then?
I was about 12. I don't know as if I was 12 years old.
Young child.
And when I got home with the money, Mama told me I had to give her all of it but 50 cents. She gave me 50 cents out of that dollar, and I had Mama took the dollar.
What'd you spend that 50 cents on?
We used to have a man did a grocery store on Green Street named Joe Holt. Mr. Holt had a little store there on Green Street. So I went in the house, I said, Mama, can I go around now to Mr. Joe and get me a black car sucker? She said, Miss Clark, Drew just gave you the nickel. And you going around and I give it to Mr. Drew. I said, Mama, it don't cost but a penny. So Mama told me, yeah, I could go. I went around and bought that black car sucker for one penny. So I came back home with four pennies. Went in the house and showed them to Mama. She said, what you gonna do with it? I went, you know, they used to build the houses way up off the ground then.
Like on the stilts. Like.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Brick pillars. I went up under the house, dug a hole. I was telling Miss Jamie about it. Put me a brick on the bottom of that, sit this can, this baking hot powder can on that brick. Cut me a hole in the top and put them four pennies in there, and that's when I've been had a penny from that day to this one. God bless me with that. And on Sunday morning when we dressed to go to Hoses Temple, the post office where it is now used to be Westland College. And we were passed by them white girls was out there to see us go to Sunday school every Sunday morning. And we went by there, and they would wave at us and all. And they say we were the cutest little black girls that could, you know, dress up for Sunday school. But finally they moved Westland College and put the post office there. That's where the Macon post office used to be down there on Mulberry Street when I worked at the equipment office. And I never will forget the day when I was able to go down and work on Mulberry Street to McClure Equipment Office. My baby brother was a truck driver, and I was the one who cleaned up and delivered little packages around to the stores in Macon.
And when did you go to work there?
I went to work there after I was 12, 13 years old.
So you're very young. Now let me go back. You moved into Pleasant Hill before you started school. Tell me about school for you. Where did you go to school?
I went to school at Green Street School. Miss Anna Goodwin was my first grade teacher. Miss Susan Tripp was my third grade teacher. And Miss Danford was my seventh grade teacher, and I come out of school in seventh grade at Green Street.
Green Street was where Walnut Street is now, is that right? Mm-hmm. Where was Green Street School at, do you remember?
Up there on Green Street.
Is that where?
On the corner of Madison, where
it's a, I don't know what the name of it now. Yeah, I think that Reverend, what was his name?
Tolliver.
Yeah, Reverend Tolliver's wife. But she's dead, ain't she?
No.
She's not? Mm-hmm. Oh, I didn't know that.
Back in that time, was seventh grade or eighth grade, how much schooling were you, how long did you go to school during that time?
I went from the first grade to the seventh grade at Green Street.
Okay.
And I hadn't been to school no more since, because I had to go to work to help my daddy.
Yeah. Okay. And this, you worked with the lady on Pierce, and then you got this job working there.
At the equipment office, McClure.
During that time when you were growing up, what are the childhood memories? Did you play as a child? What kind of things did you do as a child?
Oh, I didn't have no child time in my life. I just grew up, and I didn't like a whole lot of. I just didn't never do nothing ugly. If I did, I didn't know it, because Mama would tear our rumpy-tump-tump up.
So you were obedient children?
Yes, ma'am. They had to be to stay with Maddie Bailey.
Okay.
That was my mama. She wanted right. So finally, my oldest sister, she was younger than I was. She got pregnant. And the boy she was going to marry lived in Chicago. So she left him and went up there to marry him. And after that, she got up there. He come back to Macon and got a girl and married her. But I forgot what she was named and carried her back up there. So my sister married another man, John Faison. And then she had these boys.
And she was did she stay in Chicago?
Yes, yeah, she died and buried in Chicago.
And so at about 12, you started working here in Macon.
Right here in Macon.
Tell me about those teenage years for you growing up and working and at 12. Tell me about 12 until you got maybe to be a young adult. Tell me about life then.
Mama just didn't never allow us out in the street. I just worked and went home. We had to study our books. We had time. We had time to wash our socks and panties. She made us wash them in wash pans. And Mama made soap, so we would have plenty of soap. Potash soap.
I heard about that. And rub boards?
Yeah, Mama, and big tin tubs. Mama would, and when she would buy ice, the ice man would come along. She would wrap that in bag and sacks and stuff and put in them tubs where we would have cold water, you know, in jugs. Well, that's much as I can remember on Willis Street.
Do you remember the actual address of the house?
No.
You know if that house is still standing today?
No. The highway come through there.
Okay.
We lived there. Used to be a little wooden church down on Fifth Avenue called St. Mary.
Yeah, St. Mary is still the Baptist church.
Yeah, it's up on Willis Street now. Beautiful, beautiful church.
St. Mary's, it's up the street, down the street from where Fountain Temple is. Is that the same St. Mary's?
Fountain Temple on Madison.
Down that street, going towards the freeway, is that St. Mary's? I think so. That side street, that must be Fifth.
No, it ain't. It's, I told you it was Woodley Street.
Okay. Yeah.
Jimmy, get that book for
the right one?
Woodley Street there.
So your house would have been down past that?
Yeah, way down the hill where the branch was.
By the branch. I've heard a lot about the branch.
Yeah, we used to cross the branch and had an alley. At the foot of Woodley Street, that's some of St. Mary's information.
Okay.
When they had their anniversary.
88th anniversary, St. Mary's Missionary Baptist
Church. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I noted when it was a wooden building, two rooms and a kitchen, too.
What kinds of things, you mentioned several of the stores, were there other places in Pleasant Hill when you were growing up, places that you went or businesses that you went to during that time?
Business.
Mm-hmm. Stores or?
Henry Hampton had a grocery store.
Do you remember where that was?
On corner 4th Avenue and 4th Avenue, corner 4th Avenue and what? Monroe Street? No. Mill Street. Corner 4th Avenue and Mill Street.
And you would go there for what kinds of things?
Everything you need to eat.
Okay. That was your regular grocery store?
No, Willie Matthews would have a regular grocery store, but Mr. Hamp was kin to my mama, so mama just would go up. His wife was mama's kinfolk.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And then we'd go over there and pick up stuff for her.
So then growing up, you worked, how long did you work down Mulberry Street?
Till he went out of business.
Okay, so you stayed there for a long time?
Long time. I never will forget, he taught us to save a little money. This white man did. And Mr. McClure. And one Monday morning, he called me to his office. He said, "Kate, go up to that person and get your money out of there." I said, "No, sir. I didn't have enough money in there to go get," but he knew. He taught us to save some money. And he had me $50. My brother, Ernest, was driving the truck. He was old enough to go to work to drive the truck, to carry heavy things around wherever it had to go. And he gave him $100. He said, "Y'all go up there and get that money out of that bank and carry it down there to the bank where just owned was the Macon Federal." And I've been with them ever since. That's years, and I think they said it was 80-some years. I've been with them.
It's BB&T now.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. What kind of jobs did you have? You said you started out cleaning up and making deliveries. Tell me the kinds of jobs that you had while you worked there.
The last job that I had was working for a white lady named Miss Emory. Emory Highway in Macon.
Yes.
Her husband was a captain in the Army. And he named that Emory Highway. It's an airport supposed to be out that way somewhere, but I never did get to it. And she lived in the Massey apartment on the 6th floor on College Street. And I worked for her, and so she died on my arm. And she left me everything she had. Bought my house right down there on Forest Avenue. And that's where I really began to get my start. She left me all her money in the bank and everything.
Do you remember what year that was?
No. I got a paper in that drawer there. If I had known, I could have got.
Well, about how old you were?
Oh, I was grown, done had a baby, and he was grown and done moved from Macon to Illinois. But he died.
Now, let me go backwards.
You were working. You were a youngster. At some point, you got married.
Yeah.
Had some children. Tell me about that part of your life.
The first boy I married was named Willie Tom Farley.
When was that?
Oh, Lord, I don't know.
About how old were you?
About 16. If I was that old, I think I was about 16 or 17. I'm not sure. But I married him. We were married 3 years. I was just telling Miss Jamie the other day. He told me to dress up and he was going to take me out that evening because we had been married 3 years. I was living right down there on Lincoln Avenue. Mm-hmm. And with my mother, she had never left here. That's been years ago.
So what happened? This is your third year anniversary, so you got dressed up. What happened?
We went out and he went out to a club they call the Cotton Club down on Poplar. I think it was on Poplar Street. And it was crowded with girls and boys dancing and going on. And he set a quart of beer up on table and wanted me to drink it. And I told him, because God didn't tell me to drink. And I wasn't going to drink nothing. I go to Sunday school and church and I ain't drinking. He said, I brought you out here to have a good time and you going to enjoy. So he poured that beer all over me, all over that pretty white dress. And it was cheap. It went to rolling up. I'm telling Jamie about it.
And then what happened? Because now I'm curious. And then what happened?
I sit there and I cried. So I got up. I said, now I got to go to the restroom to see if I can, you know, get my dress dried out. So, and he had done got high. I come out and it was a man out there drove a cab named Willie Flournoy, and he dead now. He said, sister, what in the hell happened to you? I told him Willie had pulled this bill on me, and I said, Willie, will you take me home? He said, yeah, and I'm going in there and whoop his. So I said, no, let him alone. I got it worked out. When he got to my house, I had took a sheet off the bed, tied every piece he had, put it on the front porch, locked the screen door, and locked the front door so he couldn't get in.
Woo.
He went and got his aunt. Miss Viola, she had a restaurant on Monroe Street cross from Willie Massey's store. They got in the car and come back over there. So I wouldn't let him in. She told him to get his clothes and come on. I was already a member of the church. I was serving my God. What Mama taught me to, I walk by faith, not by sight. I walk by faith, honey. I tell you, I love the way of the Lord. I think about it sometimes, but I praise God for everything. I don't hate nobody. I tell you, I've had a good life. God has blessed me. I come from a long way. Don't nobody know but me. I got rid of him. So the man when I married was a sweet man. That was John Wesley Ray.
Now with the first husband, you didn't have any children?
No.
And then how much later, how much time passed before you married again?
Oh, I don't know, because I told you I had that baby through a mistake.
Okay.
I had one son.
Now that was after Willie?
Yeah.
Okay. So about how much later?
Honey, I don't know. So much in life has passed by, 101. I can't think of all of it. I don't know why Diane wants y'all to see me.
Now, tell me, your son, what was his name?
Willie Andrew Dickerson.
Mm-hmm. And you said he's deceased?
Yeah, he was smoking. He was a mail coach on the Central Railroad. He ran from Chicago to Los Angeles and smoking cigarettes, and I kept telling him, I said, it's going to give you cancer. So he had lung cancer, and that's what he died with. He buried in Chicago. My mama buried in Chicago. My sister and brothers, all of them buried in Chicago but me.
Now, you were then a single woman, a single mother. Tell me how you made it. Tell me how you made it.
I made it because I was honest with myself, and I was honest in the faith of Christ, and he kept me with a job. Like I told you about Miss Emery, the white lady I worked for in the Massey apartment on the 6th floor. I never will forget that. Her husband named Emery Highway. It's an airport out that road somewhere. But she left me everything. God has opened a menu door for me.
Before that, did you have other jobs before that? What kind of work did you do?
None other than Miss Davis. No, I told you I worked on Pierce Avenue.
Uh-huh.
And I just went out there on Sunday evenings and cleaned up.
And were you a young woman when you started working for the lady there at the on the 6th floor?
Yeah.
So you worked for her for some time?
I worked for her for a long, long time. I tended her because she was a widow.
And so that allowed you to take care of your son all the way up through?
I didn't have to take care of him because he was grown. He lived in Chicago.
Now, did you raise him here in Macon?
Mm-hmm. He went to school here and graduated from Hudson High.
Hudson High. Where did he go to elementary school at?
Who?
Your son. Remember what elementary school he went to?
Catholic, right down the street.
St. Peter Clayton.
St. Peter. Graduated from St. Peter's.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Went to Hudson. Hudson High. Is Hudson where the Booker T. Washington Center is now? Is that where the Hudson?
No. I don't know what's over there now, Jimmy.
Booker T. Washington.
Booker T. Yeah, that corner where the Booker T. Washington Center is, I think is where the old Hudson High was before they built Ballard Hudson.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's where my sister graduated from, too.
Hudson or
Hudson.
Okay.
All of them graduated but me.
Okay.
I went through 7th grade at Green Street. And Mama said I had to work because Daddy, you know, was working at the railroad, and they laid him off.
Okay.
I told you about that. And we had to help Daddy.
Do you remember him working after he was laid off?
Worked at the Macon Waterworks.
Okay, Waterworks.
It's a lake of that name after one of the boys worked at the... What was his name? Lucas. One of the Lucases.
The son. Yeah. Elaine Lucas's son. They named that lake after, or memorial. The Lucas family.
One of them lakes up that name, because he used to come and see us all, me and my husband, all the time.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So, were you, this was later in life when you got married? The second time. Tell me what age or so, do you remember what part of life that was?
When I married Mr. Ray.
Mr. Ray,
It was a beautiful life.
And by how old were you when you got married that second time?
Oh, about 80. I don't know.
About 80?
Huh?
You said you were about 80?
75 or 80.
Okay, so this was later in life.
Yeah, because he ain't... How long... You didn't know Jim. Jimmy, did you know J.W.? Yeah, I thought you did.
Okay.
Because I was living on Forest Avenue when he died, Wanda.
In growing up, tell me where you lived. You told me where you lived when you moved here to Macon. Where else did you live? You said Lincoln Avenue. When you were married the first time, you were living on Lincoln Avenue?
Mm-hmm.
Where else have you lived here in Pleasant Hill?
When I first came to Macon, we lived on Willis Street. We left Willis Street and went to Mohawn Street. And when we left Mohawn, we went to Third Avenue. From Third Avenue to Ward. And I moved from Ward Street to Forest Avenue. And when I moved from Forest Avenue, I moved up here.
What was your address on Forest Avenue?
271 Forest Avenue.
Do you remember any of the other addresses that you lived? Ward Street or any of the others?
I didn't live in but one house on Forest Avenue.
No, on the other streets you lived on. Do you remember the addresses?
No, I don't know the one where I left from First Avenue. Mm-hmm. I left First Avenue and went to Ward Street. That's when Miss Emery.
What's his full name?
Who?
J.W.
John Wesley Ray.
John Wesley Ray, and that's W-R-A-Y.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So you were older in life when you... And how did you meet him?
At church. Okay. I told him I didn't want... That man didn't know how to serve God. I love the word Jesus. And when we was in church one Sunday... He got up with the gun, what was close to me was Mary Taylor. Me and her was sitting up, and she saw him when he got up on the far side of New Hope. She said, Katie, getting up. And he went on around there, and he joined the church under Reverend T.J. Lynch.
Was this at Holsey?
No, at New Hope.
At New Hope. Okay.
He joined New Hope. I left Holsey Temple, you know.
When?
I don't know when it was. It's been so long. Yeah. When Mama gave me a chance, when New Hope moved from Wooded Street to Third Avenue, I just told him about that. And two rooms and a kitchen. It was a branch. Now you see the highway come through there now.
Oh, I didn't know that. So before they were on Third Avenue, they were down by the branch.
On Wooder Street.
Okay. And so when they moved, you joined up at New Hope.
Yeah, but I don't know what year it was.
And you've been a member there ever since?
Yes, ma'am. I've been there 80-some years, I think. Lucille said, I've been there 81 or 82 years. I've been at New Hope ever since. I want nothing but a child, in a way. Because I always thought that God wanted you to make a joyful noise unto the Lord. And that's what I used to tell Mama. I said, Mama, you hear them sanctified folks up there in Rock Hill making a joyful noise unto the Lord all of, and I couldn't say I said all of the land.
How were you involved with the church? Were you a part of any of the auxiliaries or the boards? Tell me what your involvement has been.
I sang in the choir 40 years. When I got to be a diabetic, and it, you know, I went to complaining And so I had to come out the choir. I sang in the choir for the year. And I organized the junior mission. I organized the junior mission. Excuse me. Hello? Hey, let me call you back. I got company right now. Okay, precious. Bye-bye. My godson.
So you said you sang in the choir, you organized the juniors?
I organized the junior mission. They had a senior mission, which Miss Clark now is the senior. I think this is it. Yeah, that's some of our missionaries. Sister Lucille Clark is out. What is that?
Willie Norwood.
Huh?
Willie Norwood? Looks like somebody's...
That's somebody died back there. I don't know him.
Okay. Tell me, part of our project is collecting the history of Pleasant Hill. Tell me about your fondest memories. You've lived here a long time. Tell me some of the fondest memories you have about Pleasant Hill.
Some of what?
The memories. The best memories you have of Pleasant Hill or living here.
Well, I can't say. Because I've enjoyed my life, because I have tried to walk in the light for Jesus.
Let me ask you a question.
Ask me.
I don't get to meet many people that are 101 years old. You have lived a long time, and it sounds like you have lived a good life. You've enjoyed it.
I have.
We're recording history for someone else that wants to know the secret. I think you were getting ready to touch on that, of living a good life. 101 years of good life. Tell me how you do that.
Just love everybody. Do what God said, do unto others as you have them do unto you. I remember one time a lady told a lie on me, and I know it wasn't true. And I prayed about it. The Lord said, God said, surprise her. I went downtown where I was working at and went to a lawyer's office. So he said, she got anything in the case? He said, I get it. For I said, I don't want a thing from her but love. He said, well, I'm going to scare the hell out of her. And he wrote her a letter. I told her, I said, now our back fence is fence to fence. You never called me to the fence to ask me how I felt, and I never called you. You got a telephone, I got one. Long time before I was able to have a telephone, because they didn't let us have. When I first come in, we didn't have no wires and things for telephone. And I told her, I said, you could have been a neighbor if you'd wanted, but you didn't. And the next thing I know, she was on the, we'd ride the bomber, but she'd stand up before she would sit down beside me. Arlie Stubbs, that's what she would name, Miss Arlie Stubbs. So when this lawyer wrote her this letter, like to scare her that she come around that big, and I said, it's too late. I said, but I still love you, I'm going to still be in the cave. I'll always be where the Lord can use. All of my life, girl, I have served the Lord, and I know I've done my best, and I'm still gonna do it. I've been a member of New Hope 80 something years. I never will forget my church. And one of my nephews in Chicago who work at his school, he's a finance secretary at his college where he graduated from. I was telling him how much I pay. In the church, after the holy book say pay 10 cents, you know, out of every dollar. And when he added it up, he called me back. He says, "Anki, do you know how much you paying over tithes and offerings?" I said, "No." He said, "You paying $50 a month, more than tithes and offerings." I said, "Cut it out and use it." I said, "The Lord supplying every one of my needs. I don't need it. I give it where it's needed. Let the church have it." So now when I'm gone, dead and gone, I got a little young man gonna sing for me. Let the church say amen.
Is that your favorite song?
Well, that's one of them.
Tell me what your favorite songs would be. You were in the choir. What would have been your favorite songs?
Blessed Assurance. Do you know that? Singing.
Oh, me and singing. I was not in the choir. You sing.
You don't have to be
blessed
in the choir.
Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine.
Yeah.
Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine.
Divine. Yeah.
Would you mind singing it?
No, I can't now.
That's the one, though. That's the right one, huh?
Yeah, honey. I tell you, and let the church say amen.
I don't think I know that one.
It's just a... Just a hymn, like.
I don't think I know that. Let the church say amen. I don't know that one.
Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. God has spoken. Let the church say amen. And Carlton Kitchen can sing it. He's a young black boy.
Carlton
Kitchen.
Is he from here?
Yeah.
Carlton Kitchens.
I don't know. He used to be a member of, what is Ed Smith Church? Name.
Who?
Eddie Smith.
Macedonia.
Yeah.
Baptist.
He used to be a member there. I don't know why he a member that, because he over New Hope all the time. Uh-huh.
It sounds like you have lived a life that you have been pleased with.
I'm still pleased with it. And every morning, every night, all through the day. And I don't know nobody I've never done anything to in my life. I've never talked about folks. I never will forget that lady. God bless her, she in her grave.
It sounds like that's a good formula for how to live.
Well, everybody tell me, say, "Miss Kate, I don't know what you is." I say, "I'm a child of the King."
Now, but this started somewhere. Where did you get these values? Are these the lessons that your parents taught you?
Yes, ma'am. My mama didn't allow us to do anything to anybody. My mama didn't allow us to lie. We couldn't tell lies in the highway. She fed us and clothed us. She said that God didn't give us to her for us to rule her. And we had to walk by the light of Christ. And I'm telling you, from childhood, I never will forget over there on Woody Street. That day when Miss Mary Pinson wanted to come down there with that lamb to whoop me about getting in that ditch crying to go to school. I've had a good life. That's my clock.
Oh, okay.
Yes, ma'am.
We are, this project is about collecting the history. Is there anything else that you would like to share that you would want future generations to know about you, about Pleasant Hill, about the kind of life that you've lived and the experiences you've had? Is there anything else you'd like for us to make sure that we record and that we keep in history?
I hope it's something in there that would do some good, but I don't know.
Anything else on your heart that you would want shared for future generations to know, to hear? Any wisdom, anything that you'd like to share?
Get in a good church. Listen to your pastor and become a Christian. Become a child of the King. Because he will, I'm telling you, I know he will take care of you. Because he can supply all of your needs. You can't do it, but God can. I don't know nothing else, but I've had a good life, and I've had many. I had one person to tell that lie on me, but I straightened her out. And when she met me at A&P, she begged me pardon, but it was too late. I told her I'm through with her. But if she speak to me, I was there for her, and anything I had that she needed, she could get it. I still was Anna Kate Bailey Ray.
Well, you have been an inspiration to talk to.
I hope I said something good that would help.
In being able to just hear the life that you've lived, be able to hear how your faith has taken you, even when people do you wrong. You know, to hear how you are able to be true to your faith and to be able to walk in your
faith. That's what Diane said, Diane Moore. Mm-hmm. I never will forget them. When my husband died, they were round in my house. Diane Moore, I don't know what they were, and her mama was so sweet. She worried me to death about going getting food. I got a brother, Patrick, Randy Pat. What is brother Patrick's name, Jimmy? I think his name Randy Pat. He worked at the hospital for years before he retired. It was the Macon Hospital. I had two falls in my life. I fell right between that one Sunday morning where you are. I went over there to get something and fell back through there. And then I was walking outside by myself with this walker. And I didn't know that I tumbled and fell out. That ain't been a year, is it?
But you seem like you're in good health, sharp mind,
they carry
able body.
They carry me. I got stuff over there now. I'm fixing to make one of my members a cake. Honey,
I should have waited till this afternoon to come. What kind of cake you making, Miss Ray?
I'm going to make a pound cake. I got my butter and stuff all up there.
And Diane said you were up fixing breakfast. Somebody was fixing breakfast for you.
I fixed it.
You were up fixing.
I cooked me some grits this morning and fried me a piece of ham, but the ham wasn't good, so I threw it in the garbage can.
At 101 years old.
Yes, ma'am.
To be sharp-minded, be able to remember names and streets, to be able to get up, fix your breakfast, and make somebody else a cake.
Yeah, her mother died at a, she 100 now. Counting mama 100. Huh? Yeah, cheese straws.
It's something to aspire to, that just, you know, in living a good life, to be at 101 and say, I've enjoyed my life and I haven't done wrong by people. That's something.
I appreciate you saying it, but Mama taught us it's better to give than to receive. In all of my life, I wish you could see little boys and things that are preachers now that caused me. I had one that lived on Lincoln Avenue down below me, Miss Dora Norwood, called me one evening and said, Kate, these boys down here crying. They want to go to church. One of them come up on the steps with me, David. He died, had a Madison's heart attack. He come up on the steps and he said, Miss Kate, come down here. I said, what you want, boy? I said, come on up on the porch, because I just come from where. He said, no, Miss Kate, come down on the steps. Said, me want to talk to you. I came down on the steps and sit down inside of him. I said, what you want? He said, Miss Kate, tell me how to join that Baptist church, because me want to be a Christian just like you. And he want nothing but a boy. I jumped up off some steps and in the house, and it was two teachers, Pauline and Julia Sparks, was living right across down Lincoln Avenue from me. When I squealed, they come running. They ran over there and they said, Kate, what? I said, honey, have I held the light for these boys to see Jesus through me? She said, yes, you have. And honey, the next day I come home, I couldn't hardly make it in my house. I went all up and down out there on Pierce Avenue and got a bag of nothing but boys' clothes, brought home, put them in my washer, washed them. Next night I come home, I ironed till 12 o'clock and went to bed. And then when I called them, Dora, they mama, she was named Dora Norwood. She said, Kate, come to the front. Say, the boys coming by. And I went out there, this up, and I screamed and run back and shut the door, because I didn't want to see. But they was cute. Everybody wanted to say, God, Kate. And from that day to this, I've been had nothing but preachers, Reverend David Stanley, Norwood. I got one over there come to our church. See that little picture over in there with a man standing with me in that cabinet? In this cabinet right there. See that preacher right there?
There's one here.
Oh, That's Sister Clark's nephew, that.
There's one here, though. Is that you with that hat on?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it is.
Uh-huh. Well, the young man there. And then it's you, look like he's got two ladies, one on both sides of him.
Well, that's the one. He saw me in the church, and he been calling me. He called me a sweetie. I don't care where it go.
Now, the cab driver, who was the cab driver?
My husband.
That was Mr. Ray.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. They told me that you married a cab driver.
Yeah. Uh-huh. But I didn't marry him till he come to know Christ.
Yeah. Well, do you remember what year you got married?
No, I'd have to go look on the license, but I didn't know. We were married when he got sick. I had to put him in nursing home. But I never will forget Dr. Hutchins.
Now, who was Dr. Hutchins? Was that his doctor?
That was his doctor, Dr. Hutchins. They the one on the funeral home downtown.
Yeah.
Hutchins
Funeral Home.
Okay. He called upstairs and told me I was in the hospital going to sit with it. He said, go home and get you some rest. You've been up here ever since 9:30 this morning. I said, Dr. Hutchins, I ain't ready to go. He said, I want you to go home. I said, all right then. So I called a friend of mine. He come and got me and carried me home at 11:15 my phone. I said, who they calling me this time? And he said, Miss Ray, say, how you feeling? I said, I feel pretty good. I said, I just got him. Who this? He said, Dr. Hutchins. I said, what's the matter? He kind of blowed. Then he said, J.W. be gone. I said, oh, my God. I said, do I have to get up? He said, no, you don't have to come Monday or Tuesday. Just tell me where you want the body. I said, send it to you, to your daddy, because they was good friends of mine. Him, his daddy and his brother, all of them was good friends. They would come down. Everybody seemed like they was crazy about me, and I don't know why. I tried to walk in the light and still trying. I hope I ain't got too many more. If I hear Sister Clark hear me say that, she'll bless me out.
Well, your work's still not done. We're glad that you gave us your time today.
Well, I'm proud of y'all. Y'all had time to come and listen to my story. I hope it's something in it that would help you, whatever.
Well, it has encouraged me.
God bless.
It has encouraged me, and we just appreciate it. I want to thank you. Thank you for being here.